This program was paid for by Water of Life Church. From Water of Life Ministries in Plano, Texas, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob is speaking through his servants to the world. He that hath ears to hear, let him hear what the Spirit of the Lord is saying today. Let us join Doyle Davidson and others of Water of Life, sowing the Word of God in spirit and in truth.
Hello, I'm Doyle Davidson, servant and apostle of the Lord Jesus Christ, ministering locally to the body of Christ in Dallas, Fort Worth, Texas, sent by God to your house to declare to you the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. 1 Corinthians 15, 3 and 4, tell us what the gospel is, how that Jesus Christ died for our sins, according to Scripture, he is buried, he rose again, third day, according to the Scripture. Thank God, Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he's anointed me, preach the gospel to the poor, sent me to heal broken heart, preach deliverance to the captives, come with sight to the blind, set at liberty them that are bruised. The word is nigh thee, even in your heart, in your mind, is a word of faith, which I preach. You will confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus, believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead. You shall be saved with the heart, man, believing unto righteousness, and the mouth confession is made unto salvation. Thank God. Amen. Thank God. Amen. I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. It is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believes, the Jew first, also to the Greek. Therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by his faith. I want to welcome everyone receiving this broadcast on live stream, Roku, Apple TV, YouTube, and other devices. Kathie Davidson, my co-host, at my left. Good morning. How are you?
Doing well.
Good. Thank God we will have Terre Brown come and do a song after two songs by Terre, by Recorded and Water of Life Boys. But before Terre speaks, would you read Ezekiel 36?
Sure will.
So, right now, let's have Terre Brown's recorded songs with a lot of Water of Life Boys. Terre Brown is here. She's going to sing a song, minister to you, after Kathie Davidson reads from Jeremiah 31, Ezekiel 36. And I want to say this because God taught me the Bible. Man didn't. I've not been to any Bible college or any seminary or did I attend some Bible study taught by a prophet or an apostle. The Father and Jesus taught me. So, I want Kathie to read both these, and we've got to get Isaiah that talks about a new covenant, but not today.
Right.
So we're speaking to people that don't know the Bible, and they've been listening to people that'll say anything.
Amen.
We just want to put the truth out, all right?
Amen.
All right, would you read this?
All right, I'm going to read from Jeremiah 31. Behold, the days come, saith the Lord. No, I'm sorry, 31. Behold, the days come, saith the Lord, that I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah, not according to the covenant I made with their fathers in the day I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, which my covenant they break, although I was an husband unto them, saith the Lord. But this shall be the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel. After those days, saith the Lord, I will put my law in their inward parts and write it in their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people.
See, this is written in the heart. The old covenant's written on tables of stone.
Amen.
All right?
Amen.
Thank you. Next, Ezekiel.
Ezekiel 36, starting in verse 25. Then will I sprinkle clean water upon you, and you shall be clean from all your filthiness. From all your idols will I cleanse you. A new heart also will I give you, and a new spirit will I put within you. And I will take away the stony heart out of your flesh, and I will give you an heart of flesh. And I put my spirit within you, and cause you to walk in my statutes, and you shall keep my judgments and do them. And you shall dwell in the land that I gave to your fathers, and you shall be my people, and I will be your God.
You see, folks, I want you to understand, there are two covenants. The first one was the Ten Commandments. The second one we just read about. The church is so confused, but they're confused because of the people that are teaching. I mean, the Bible, a fifth grader can read them, but these people can't. They're blinded. Are blinded because of the wickedness of their heart. Terre Brown will do. That's what the cross is for.
Is your mind confused and cluttered? Life has your back against the wall. Mercy's been there in the shadows. Your heart won't let him in at all. There's a cross of pain where Jesus bore all the burden of your sin. A place where dying deep inside, new life wells up again. He eternal life you'll gain. cross is for. Oh, my friend, I've been where you are, lost in that cold and lonely place. Your mind is filled with such despair, pain is etched upon your face. Listen, child, the answer is the cross you'll find. Jesus there, it's true. Oh, I too was lost, I've been set free. He'll do the same for you. He wants to ease your pain. Eternal life you'll gain. He's standing by your door. That's what the cross is for. That's what the cross is for. Thank
you. I woke up this morning with a strange verse of scripture in my heart. So Kathie's going to read it, and I'm going to tell you a strange testimony.
All right. It is James 1:21. Wherefore, lay apart all filthiness and superfluity of naughtiness, and receive with meekness the engrafted word, which is able to save your souls.
Lay aside everything. That's what that says. But the word of God, which is what? Able to save your soul.
Able to save, right. Yeah. It is able.
Did you know, I told a preacher this once, a television preacher, television station owner, and he could hardly stand it. I said, did you know you need your soul saved? Not just your spirit. Well, brother, the soul and the spirit are the same. I didn't know that, did you?
Can't be.
1 Thessalonians chapter 5 says there's a spirit, soul, and body. I wish you people would study where you start preaching. Oh, by the way, there was a man that I ministered with in Garland, Texas, Bell Gospel. And I wish I could remember his name. Somebody will. He died for 14 minutes. He was dead, 14. And his wife told the physicians, you do what you do, I'm going to pray. That's what I do. And the man came back to life. Well, God told him not to go anywhere and talk. He was Assemblies of God. Until God told him to. One day, he got a phone call from CBN, Pat Robertson, and invited him to go on CBN, Pat Robertson interviewed him. And I happened to minister with him at Bell Gospel. But when he went to heaven, he was an Assemblies of God. And the Lord said, as I recall, something like this. Don't go anywhere till you study the Bible.
Amen.
An AG preacher, and the Lord says, don't go anywhere till you study the Bible. I don't know if this guy was a preacher. Anyway, somebody will remember this man. Very humble. He asked me if I'd come minister with him. Well, I ministered with two that went to heaven. Another one, 20 minutes, and died in an automobile accident in New Mexico. And his sister, I guess, prayed for him. They were in a wreck, car wreck. And he came back to life. And he ministered at Water of Life Church. And he lives near Houston. And I forgot his name. Goodness sake.
Well, you won't forget Elliot Hodge's name.
Elliot Hodge, no.
And he died three times.
That's right. I went to church with him.
Right.
Right. He went to heaven three times. Elliot did.
Yes, he did.
Right. He knew my family well. My family.
Prayed for.
My aunt, my uncle, others prayed for it. My uncle or my grandfather gave him a blood transfusion, gave blood for a blood transfusion.
Right.
Amen. So, I've been around one, went to heaven three times, and two that went to heaven, and one dead 20 minutes, one 14. I tell you, God hadn't missed one thing exposing me to people.
Amen.
That had been involved in spiritual things. Now, where was I headed?
We were talking about James 1.
Oh, James 1. Back in the mid-70s, let's say 75, after I was anointed at the Tomb of the Garden, June 16th, 74, I was confronted by God with my wedding vows. Matt and I got married when I was in the Navy. I went to high school with her, and a year, dated her three, joined the Navy, and went through boot camp, and then went back to San Diego. I was going to hospital court school. God said, you need to marry Patty. So I did. Not that easy. I was in the Navy, and I couldn't believe God would want me to have a wife. But it turned out it was God and the best thing for me. That, I'll assure you. She went to Japan with me, her daughter, Kathie, by for 20 months. But I was confronted that when they, Pat and I were married in Linda Vista Presbyterian Church, Linda Vista, California. Presbyterian preacher. And we vowed to stay with one another through sickness. Well, there's nothing wrong with that, but we vowed to be sick.
Amen.
Huh?
Amen.
Oh, no. We vowed to be together in poverty. No. I'm not going there. I'm not going to live in poverty. I'm not going to live in sickness. Anybody remember a third one? I don't recall. Now, but my goodness, I said to Patty, do you think that I was silly enough to vow that I'd live with you being sick? I'm going to stay with you. That's my intention. But my intention is not to get sick. Well, guess what? I took care of Patty. About 12 years sick because of her pride. She yielded to an evil devil that told her to lay hands on her knees and say, be filled with the Holy Ghost. Well, they both were already filled with the Holy Ghost, bigger than done. But Pat never lived in poverty.
Amen.
No way. Her mother once sent her a letter with a gift and said, you have everything. It's difficult to know what to buy you. Well, it wasn't because her husband was stupid. Religious. Yes. That's just pure stupid to vow you'll be live in poverty when God made you rich. 2 Corinthians 8:9. Glory. I tell you, I told Patty, we're getting rid of that silly marriage certificate license where we vowed to live in poverty and sickness. Not me. I'm not going to do it. You say, well, no, you take things too serious. I'm not dumb. Not one moment am I dumb. Amen.
You know, to go right along with that, God had you get rid of all your medical books.
My what?
All your medical books.
Yes, he did. You know what else he did? I was licensed as a veterinarian in Missouri, Texas, Tennessee. You know what God had me do? Tear up my license. I was also qualified. I passed a test that I was could be licensed in 31 states with an oral examination. I got none of that. None of it. Thank God. My friends, you can bow. And you better get rid of them. Because to bow before God, to God, you will end up doing. Don't kid yourself. God does not ignore frivolous speech. What time is it?
It is 11:32. Did that, when you realized that about the vows and you were in Argyle, was that when you were in poverty? Because you were there for a little while.
Wasn't making a bit of money.
Yeah.
That's what pushed me on.
Amen.
Just so happened by the bat I were sick. But you better know it's poverty. Couldn't make a red cent. Oh, I was angry at myself.
Amen.
Not anyone else. But I'll tell you, that renounce that silly vow before I got out of Argyle.
Amen.
You ask me a question, I'll give you a full-fledged answer. God cleaned up my plow before I got out of Argyle. Thank God, in one day, April, 1977, God said, go back to McKinney. I went and told Pat, she didn't understand. Next thing, God told me where to go, the office, how much to pay for it, who owned it, and that to be rezoned. No, had to have Anyway.
An exemption?
No.
Okay.
I can't think of what it's called. Anyway, I had to go before ordinance and the ordinance change.
Right.
That was it. Thank God. Amen. I walked in to the city office in McKinney. Thank God. And there was a man, city secretary walked by. No. Yeah. Good Lord. Well, I wasn't ready for this, but God doesn't care. Amen. He was the city engineer. And he stopped and he said, are you Dr. Davidson? I said, yes. He said, last week we were discussing that we didn't have a law governing a veterinary hospital or office. We need one. Would you tell, sit down and tell that man right there what you want and I'll approve it.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, that's God.
That's how God works.
Amen. So I told him, I'm sure it's been changed. I made it lenient.
For your benefit.
Yes. Why not? Thank God. Amen. Thank God. Thank God. Hallelujah. Time.
It is 11:36.
36?
Yes.
Turn to Jeremiah chapter 1.
All right.
I'll show you part of my ministry. You there?
I'm there.
Read. First one.
First verse?
Huh?
Jeremiah chapter 1.
Keep reading until you start rooting out,
okay.
Pulling down, blowing down, tearing down, destroying, planting and building.
All right. The words of Jeremiah, the son of Hilkiah, of the priests that were at Anathoth on the land of Benjamin, to whom the word of the Lord came in the days of Josiah, the son of Amon, king of Judah, in the 13th year of his reign. It came also in the days of Jehoiakim, the son of, oh, I love when you do this to me, Josiah, king of Judah, under the end of the 11th year of Zedekiah, the son of Josiah, king of Judah, under the carrying away of Jerusalem captive in the fifth month. Then the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, before I formed thee in the belly, I knew thee. Before thou camest forth out of the womb, I sanctified thee, and I ordained thee a prophet unto the nations. Then said I, Ah, Lord God, behold, I cannot speak, for I am a child. But the Lord said unto me, Say not, I am a child, for thou shalt go to all that I shall send thee, and whatsoever I command thee, thou shalt speak. Be not afraid of their faces, for I am with thee to deliver thee, saith the Lord. Then the Lord put forth his hand and touched my mouth. And the Lord said unto me, Behold, I have put my words in thy mouth. See, this day I have set thee over the nations and over the kingdoms to root out and to pull down and to destroy and to throw down and to plant or to build and to plant.
That happened to me. My mother told God to give me a son. I'll give him back to you. And then, when I was born, I was a blue baby. They couldn't do anything for me. I had one of the top pediatricians taking care of me. He was a Navy pediatrician. Dr. D.L. Moody, Joplin, Missouri, killed in a plane crash. He said the mother can't help him. He checked with everybody he knew. Couldn't do anything for me. Mother comes home, throws me on the bed. I teased her once in a while. I said, so you wanted to get rid of me, did you? Doyle, come on. My mother and I were great friends. There's a picture somewhere of her and I standing side by side.
Amen.
That was amazing how God had that picture made. I didn't even know it. I was home from Texas. They wanted a picture. I ended up standing by mother. And man, of course the girl said, well, of course, she was your pet. Need to get that out. Amen. But God healed me. And I was a prophet. I learned about it when I was probably 60 years old. I couldn't believe what God was doing, what he did with me. You know, I'm going to say this. It's in my heart. I believe God had never meant this to me. Because he didn't want me to know it. He said, probably caused me to not want to do any, serve him at all.
Amen.
That's what I believe. Well done.
It is 11:41.
31?
4:1.
4:1.
We've got 20 minutes left.
Well, my friends, all your vows that you're so proud of, you know what? I think somewhere it says, if your conversation, let your conversation just be yay
or nay.
Or nay, right?
Yes or no.
Right. Nothing else.
It says all other is,
amen.
I can't remember the word, but yes.
I can't either. Thank God. Please, God. Hallelujah. Thank God. Thank God. You want to talk?
You ready for me too?
Yes.
All right. Let's go. Let's go first to Acts 1. We're still talking about this Jesus. Now Jesus has been raised from the dead. And we talked yesterday about Jesus going into heaven and sprinkling his blood in the heavenlies, in the heaven, or the holiest of holies in the heavens. And that is where we were redeemed and justified and sanctified by that blood. That blood, Jesus' own blood. Now, Jesus came back. And he taught, and he was, let's go to Acts 1. Let's see what he did. It says, Acts 1, verse 1. Former treatises have I made, O Theophilus, of all that Jesus began to do and teach. He was the one that wrote the book of Luke. Until the day which he was taken up, after that he, through the Holy Ghost, had given commandments unto the apostles whom he had chosen, to whom also he showed himself alive after his passion by many infallible proofs, being seen of them 40 days, and speaking of the things pertaining to the kingdom of God. Jesus hung out on earth for 40 days.
Amen.
And it said, and being assembled together with them, commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem. He said, don't leave Jerusalem. He gave them a commandment. He said, but wait for the promise of the Father, which he saith, he you have heard of me. For John truly baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days hence. This is an amazing statement he said here. He said, don't leave till you get baptized in the Holy Ghost. You know, why are the rest of us leaving before we get baptized in the Holy Ghost? Why are we going out to preach before we get baptized in the Holy Ghost?
Amen.
These guys couldn't, and they were with Jesus 3.5 years.
Amen.
We need to read the word. Right. And when they therefore were come together, they asked him, saying, Lord, wilt thou this time restore again the kingdom of Israel? And Jesus said unto them, it is not for you to know the times or the seasons which the Father has put in his own power, but you shall receive power. You shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem and all Judea and in Samaria and in the uttermost part of the earth.
Thank
you know,
God.
He didn't just speak that to 11 apostles. Jesus also spoke it to somebody I know sitting in the chair beside me at the garden tomb. I think that is just too wonderful. And when he had spoken these things while they beheld, he was taken up. Now look, Jesus is taken up here. He's been with them 40 days. He has been seen with over 500 people at once, alive. And like Jesus said, handle me. I've got flesh and bones just like you have. He just didn't have any blood. And here he says he was taken up. Now notice, he didn't change before he was taken up.
Amen.
Do you want to speak?
No.
Okay. He didn't change before he was taken up. There wasn't any great transformation. He didn't then get a halo, and he didn't then turn transparent. He was just taken up. He went straight up. And he said, with the cloud received him out of their sight. And while they looked steadfastly toward heaven as he went up, behold, two men stood by them in white apparel, which also said, you men of Galilee, why stand you gazing up into heaven? This same Jesus, which was taken up from you into heaven, shall so come in like manner as they have seen him go into heaven.
Thank
now,
God.
This Jesus, what did he do? What happened to him when he was taken up? Well, if you will turn with me to John 17, because
Thank
Jesus
God.
Didn't end. Jesus didn't end just walking out of the grave.
Amen.
Jesus is still there. He is still alive. He has not changed. He is still alive. But we're going to take a look and see what happened to Jesus when he was taken up. But Jesus tells us himself in John 17, I'm going to begin in verse 4. It says, I have glorified thee on earth. This is a prayer between Jesus and the God of heaven, Jehovah. Jesus is speaking to his heavenly Father. Do you notice? Jesus is praying right here. Now, to those of you that think that the Trinity is all one, how come Jesus is on earth and he's talking to somebody in heaven?
Amen.
He's not talking to himself, folks. He's talking to his heavenly Father. There are three. He said, I have glorified thee on the earth. I have finished the work which thou gavest me to do. And he said, and now, O Father, glorify me with thine own self, with the glory which I had with thee before the world was.
Amen.
That's where he's headed. Go back to the glory he had before the world was, to go back to the Father and to be in the glory before the world was. And if you go down to verse 24, it says, Father, I will that they also, whom thou hast given me, be with me where I am, that they may behold my glory, which thou hast given me, for thou lovest me before the foundation
Amen.
Of the world. Those of you that listen to me, there are some of you that think that I'm preaching that Jesus was lesser, that he became lesser. Oh, no. No, he became greater.
Amen.
Jesus became greater. And you will see that. He was with the Father. John 1:1. The Word was with God. The Word was God. The Word was with God. Jesus was a God. But you know what? When he came down here and became flesh and died for us, was buried for us, and raised again for us, you will see he became greater. He became greater. I did not make him lesser. I am making him more.
Amen.
By the Word of God that's written in that Bible that sits on that shelf at your house that you need to take down and read, because you're responsible for these words.
Glory.
God didn't give you a Bible to put on a shelf. God gave you a Bible, and you are responsible for the words in it. All right, now, if we go to Matthew 28, 16, Jesus himself, after he was risen. And then it says, verse 16, Matthew 28, then the 11 disciples went away into Galilee, unto a mountain where Jesus had appointed them. That's where we saw in Acts 1. And when they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. And Jesus came and spoke unto them, saying, he's saying, oh, I'm just a weak man, and I'll never change.
Amen.
I'll be just like you forever. No, he didn't say that. Read the word. He said, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. All power, all authority is given unto me in heaven and in earth. That's the Jesus that came out of the grave. Turn with me to Ephesians 1, verse 18. The eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that you may know what is the hope of his calling, and the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints. And look at verse 19. What is the exceeding greatness of his power to usward who believe, according to the working of his mighty power, which he worked in Jesus when he raised him from the dead and set him at his own right hand in the heavenly places. Jesus gets to sit right next to the Father in the throne. He said, far above all principality and power and might and dominion and every name that is named, that includes your name. And not only in this world, but also in that which is to come, and has put all things under his feet, and gave him to be the head over all things, to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him that filleth all in all. That's where Jesus is sitting.
Amen.
Far above every principality, every power, and every name. Every name. Do you know that the word of God, that the Father listens to that word above the Father's name? He listens to Jesus.
Amen.
Why? Because Jesus is the one that's going to do the judging. Why? Because you got to have a judge that's been through it. And Jesus has been through it. He became a man. He became just like us. And he went to the cross. And he bore all our iniquity, our sin, our sicknesses,
Amen.
Our poverty. And he died. And he went to hell for us. And God raised him from the dead. And now the Father has set him above everything. Everything. Everything, every religion too. You got a religion that doesn't have Jesus in it? Guess what? Jesus is above your religion. You got the wrong party there, folks. You got to get to Jesus. Now, turn to Philippians 2. It's talking about what Jesus did. Philippians 2, verse 5. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made of himself no reputation, and took on him the form of a servant, was made in the likeness of men. We've gone over this verse many times. And being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Wherefore, 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 God has highly exalted him, highly exalted him, and given him a name which is above every name.
Thank God.
Every name. Jesus has been given a name above every name. And that the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow. Of things in heaven, things in earth, and things under the earth. And that every tongue shall confess Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. It's good to confess that name now, folks. Jesus became Lord. He became Lord.
Amen.
He became Lord over everything. He became Lord of heaven. He became Lord of this earth. He became Lord of you. He became Lord of every person that dwells on this earth. He became Lord of every nation. He became Lord of every king. He became Lord of every false god. He is Lord of. He is Lord of the President of the United States. He is Lord of the United States. He is Lord over every country. He was given Lord of all. Do you know that there's a wonderful verse? And I don't have it here right now ready, but he is Lord over all. Over all. And he's going to bring this earth back to the Father. And when he's got that all done, then, only then, is he going to hand it all back to the Father. Only then. But he is Lord now of all, of you, of me, and of every situation that we are in. And I want to show you a description of this man that is in heaven with the Father. Turn with me to Revelations 1. I love this description of Jesus. There are sometimes he has appeared to man and he looks just like an ordinary man. But there is sometimes when he is in judgment that he does not look like an ordinary man. If you will go with me to Revelations 1:12, this is the Apostle John, who hung out with Jesus for 3.5 years, who was an apostle of Jesus, who ministered for Jesus. And you know what? At the Last Supper, it was John that laid his head on Jesus' breast. That's how close they were. And now John is here at the Isle of Patmos, and he sees Jesus again.
Amen.
And he says, "And I turned to see the voice that spoke with me. And when I turned, I saw 7 golden candlesticks. And in the midst of the 7 candlesticks, one like unto the Son of Man, clothed with a garment down to the foot, and girt about the paps with a golden girdle." And listen to this. He said, "His head and his hairs were white like wool, as white as snow, and his eyes were as a flame of fire." His eyes were as a flame of fire. "And his feet like unto fine brass, as if they burned in a furnace, and his voice as the sound of many waters. And he had in his right hand 7 stars, and out of his mouth went a sharp two-edged sword. And his countenance was as the sun shining in his strength." That is Jesus. That is the Lord of Lords. And that is Jesus judging. And you know what his friend said? His friend John, "And when I saw him, I fell at his feet as dead." I fell at his feet as dead. That is the glory that the Lord was walking in. That is our Lord. That is the one that's over us. That is the one that's interceding for us. That is the one that can take care of any situation. He is Lord of all. Amen. And we have about 4 minutes left.
We got to read Psalm 142. That is a prayer that David prayed when he was in the cave of Adullam. That is now my prayer.
Psalm 142. "I cried unto the Lord with my voice. With my voice unto the Lord did I make my supplication. I poured out my complaint before him. I showed before him my trouble. When my spirit was overwhelmed within me, then thou knewest my path. In the way wherein I walked have they privily laid a snare for me. I looked at my right hand and beheld, but there was no man that would know me. Refuge failed me. No man cared for my soul. I cried unto thee, O Lord. I said, thou art my refuge and my portion in the land of the living. Attend unto my cry, for I am brought very low. Deliver me from my persecutors, for they are stronger than I. Bring my soul out of prison, that I may praise thy name. The righteous shall compass me about, for thou shalt deal bountifully with me."
Did you know the Lord just gave me revelation? That's my prayer too.
Amen.
I've been saying, talking about the righteous and being around me and bountifully, God has been to me.
And will be towards you.
Well, right. But I just overcame. That's my prayer. Would you read it for me again?
Sure will, because if it's your prayer, it gets answered. I cried unto the Lord with my voice. With my voice unto the Lord did I make my supplication. I poured out my complaint before him. I showed before him my trouble. When my spirit was overwhelmed within me, then thou knewest my path. In the way wherein I walked have they privily laid a snare for me. I looked at my right hand and beheld, but there was no man that would know me. Refuge failed me. No man cared for my soul.
Amen.
I cried unto thee, O Lord. I said, thou art my refuge and my portion in the land of the living. Attend unto my cry, for I am brought very low. Deliver me from my persecutors, for they are stronger than I. Bring my soul out of prison, that I may praise thy name. The righteous shall compass me about, for thou shalt deal bountifully with me.
Amen. I'll be praying this prayer.
Amen.
But what I know is I'm coming out of this pit.
Amen.
This morning, I woke up and my arms hurt. My hands were numb. And I started, it was about 5:30. I started praying. Strong. Putting things off of me. Amen. Glory. Then here, God showed me. That's your prayer.
Amen.
Enemies are too strong for me.
Amen.
They were too strong. They overpowered me.
They were too strong for Jesus.
Would you read that again?
Psalm 142?
Yes.
I cried unto the Lord with my voice. With my voice unto the Lord did I make my supplication. I poured out my complaint before him. I showed before him my trouble. When my spirit was overwhelmed within me, then thou knewest my path. In the way wherein I walked have they privily laid a snare for me. I looked at my right hand and beheld, but there was no man that would know me. Refuge failed me. No man cared for my soul. I cried unto thee, O Lord. I said, thou art my refuge and my portion in the land of the living. Attend unto my cry, for I am brought very low. Deliver me from my persecutors, for they are stronger than I. Bring my soul out of prison, that I may praise thy name. The righteous shall compass me about, for thou shalt deal bountifully with me.
I'm coming out. I've been persecuted enough. Thank God. Bless them all. They were too strong for me. They wanted to destroy me. But they didn't get it done. God was with me.
Amen.
The Father told me in August 2009, I would not die. Tongue and interpretation.
Amen.
Right? Amen. You watched me, so did others. But that bite, the devil tried to kill me. Say it, no, I will not die, I will not die, I will not die, I will not die, I will not die. My faith was coming through to fight off the devil that wanted me dead. Thank God, the devil wants everybody dead. Amen. But thank God, I'm getting on top. no other name under heaven. Just one, Jesus, a message whereby one must be saved. That's all, just that one. Speak it, be saved. Speak it after me. Jesus.
We invite you to visit Water of Life Church at 1621 18th Street in Plano, Texas. Or for further information, call area code 972-578-8082. That's 972-578-8082. Or write Doyle Davidson, Post Office Box 861327, Plano, Texas 75086. That's Doyle Davidson, Post Office Box 861327, Plano, Texas 75086. This program was paid for by Water of Life Church.